Hi, and welcome to our webinar.
Hello and welcome, a beautiful day. How's everyone doing today?
Absolutely. We're wonderful. I'm Lisa Stack, the support coordinator, and we're here with Dr.
Rob Kiltz, and it's a pleasure. Happy New Year. I think this is our first webinar of the year.
It is, yeah, first of the new year.
Awesome, awesome. And we're planning on doing these once a month, continuing through the year.
Absolutely.
And we really appreciate all you joining us and the questions, comments, and ideas to help us always do better.
Absolutely. So what we do is, if this is your first webinar, we run through as many questions as we can. So go ahead and type your questions into the question box. Don't hesitate. Don't be shy. And we will cover as many as we can. You can also access all of our old webinars. They have been recorded. And on our website, on our homepage, if you see the tab Watch Our TV, you can access all of our previously recorded sessions.
And we're really trying to sort of bring in new innovative ideas.
Absolutely.
And thoughts, and many times we learn them from you.
Yeah.
And the more you share with us your frustrations and concerns and ideas mm-hmm. that you may have learned in other places.
Absolutely.
But we're always seeking out new and bringing them right to the forefront.
Really, we really want to do is simplify the process and share as much information as we can. So we have some great new ideas coming up in the year to help you have more opportunities to sit down with our nursing staff, with our clinical staff, run through any questions before you get started with medications, and really make sure that you are clear on the process at every step.
And one of the things that we've been working on is simplifying fertility care and IVF mm-hmm. in particular. Mm-hmm. And I had the opportunity to visit Dr. Kevin Duty mm-hmm. this last Saturday in Dallas and learned a lot about a new technique, a new device mm-hmm. called InvoCell, which is a mm-hmm. small plastic culture system that goes into the vagina. It's really kind of a new idea. It's been mm-hmm. it's actually been around, but I think the technique has been improved upon. And we're going to be talking about that in the coming months mm-hmm. and offering that for our clients. Yeah. But I think really the biggest thing we like to focus on is a comprehensive approach
Absolutely.
To your fertility. And I got a call from a patient today mm-hmm. that conceived naturally mm-hmm. after many, many, many years mm-hmm. and of attempting pregnancy. Mm-hmm. And really a lot of it is through support, change yes. in diet, and change in activity. Mm-hmm. And so you just got to keep yeah. being persistent and not giving up, because there's a tendency we get very frustrated and the process is very complicated mm-hmm. and we're just like, it's not working, and what do we want to do?
Absolutely.
We want to drop out. And really it's about support, talking to someone, and that's about our support mm-hmm. group and what this is about, learning new ideas, yeah. Yoga, acupuncture, massage, meditation, mm-hmm. all really important.
Yes.
Don't give up.
Absolutely. We have our Facebook support group. If you're interested in joining, we have about 400 clients sharing in there regularly, all day, every day. It's a great Facebook support group because it's set to secret just to protect your privacy, and that everything you post, if you don't want it to show up on your newsfeed, but I'm happy to add anyone to it. And our members who are already part of the group, if you have friends, sisters, family members who you think might benefit from joining the group as well, just go ahead and add them, and I'm happy to approve it.
And there's that village,
yes.
that connection. And as women talk, they're all talking about what are you doing, mm-hmm. and they're learning something from others. And it may be we didn't talk about it, or you hadn't heard about it before.
Absolutely.
It may or may not be appropriate for you, but that's really a great way to learn sort of these new ideas. But mm-hmm. when you talk to someone that's been through it, you feel better.
Yeah.
Epinephrine, cortisol goes down, insulin level goes down, and often that's all it yeah. takes.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so let's start our first question, Lisa.
We have some questions coming in. First one, can you please talk a little bit about all of the success you're finding using HGH?
Well, interesting enough, the human growth hormone, and much of it is coming in those people who have had previous failed cycles, mm-hmm. and either poor egg quality, poor embryo quality, or low numbers. Yeah. And using the human growth hormone as a priming, and then in the stem, seems to be the very best. Although I just had a recent conversation with a colleague of mine who's been using it recently in a shorter course, mm-hmm. and then in stem by using a low dose a week prior to stem and a low dose during stem, seems to be working mm-hmm. very nicely also.
Yeah.
And typically we're using this with a combination of a higher dose gonadotropin, 450 to 600, mm-hmm. in a mixed protocol. Of either gonal or gonal F or follistim along with menopur
yeah.
or HCG as the LH, and seem to be improving on that. So, you know, this is really something that we hadn't done very much until about 2 years ago. A colleague of ours from Spain mm-hmm. presented a paper in Baltimore. I've been using it and finding some really good results in the people who have poor egg quality, poor embryo quality, and limited number of egg and embryos. So it's something that I always say, if what you're doing isn't working, you have to look towards something else. The problem is there's not a lot of good prospective randomized double-blind placebo-controlled studies. Mm-hmm. It's been around for a long time. Some people believe in it, some people don't. We're here sort of to offer it up because we've seen some improvements, and mostly in coordination with the freeze-all cycles. So if you get into that stage, you make those embryos and you freeze them, and then you plan a frozen embryo transfer as the next step. And that's with or without comprehensive chromosomal screening or PGS, where you biopsy the embryos and then freeze them. Some people want that. We're not big proponents of it, but we certainly offer it. Mm-hmm. I think it has more value and people have more embryos than those who have fewer embryos. So human growth hormone in a lower dose, shorter course, may be the next thing coming besides just, again, persistence.
Absolutely. Next question, can you overdo it with meds during stimulation? I hear of women taking things like Neupogen and Lovenox, but I was not prescribed those my first cycle. I wonder if we didn't do everything we can do to ensure success, and what can we do to prevent another failed IVF?
Well, the question always is, do you throw the kitchen sink at it the first time? You certainly need to look at it and discuss it and have that option. In general, we tend to start simple, and then if it's not working, go to more complex, because there isn't a simple formula to say, okay, you need Neupogen and human growth hormone and the IVIG and the high-dose gonadotropins. And after going to this meeting on the InvoCell and looking at a simplified or simpler approach to your fertility treatment, it may be that a lower dose gonadotropins may do just as well as the higher dose. Mm-hmm. Although we've had some really good results over the last year, and we just hate to break that trend right now. Mm-hmm. So in general, if you've had multiple failed cycles, poor egg quality, poor embryo quality, that or just recurrent implantation failure, it may be time to add those. Certainly the discussion is up front, and I've been doing this Excel spreadsheet where I'm kind of putting our, what are all the things you could do in the process? And and it really is quite long. I always, you know, say start with the fertile fatty foods. We add low-dose naltrexone. We add anything we can do to sort of help reduce stress. Do you put in the laparoscopy, hysteroscopy to look for and rule out endometriosis? And then, is it simply a straight gonadotropin? Is it a mixed protocol? You're right. This is the biggest challenge to the process. And it isn't a one thing fits all. You individualize it. You look at age, AMH, the ovarian reserve, previous cycles, and sort of discuss this whole process. I would say in general, most people aren't jumping into the laparoscopy, hysteroscopy, although I tend to recommend it far earlier. And some people don't even think it should be done. So it's really a tough one to know that answer, but that's where maybe it's like, hey, let me have a follow-up conversation with Dr. Kiltz. And many people text me 315-416-9872 or email at robert.kiltz@me.com or rkiltz@cnyfertility.com, but mostly it's connect through the portal and correspondence, and the girls will kind of, that my team will help set up a time where we can review and talk about these options and make a personalized protocol for you.
Absolutely. Next question, what would be the ideal amount of time to take low-dose naltrexone before an IVF cycle?
Well, I've got this idea that the 30-day prime and prep is good for anyone. And I think the low-dose naltrexone, or LDN, is really valuable since I believe most of infertility is related to a dysfunctional immunologic system for all of us. And low-dose naltrexone seems to reduce the opiate receptors and reduce inflammation. It's been around a long time. If you just Google LDN, Dr. Phil Boyle in Ireland's used it for a long time, but at least 30 days. And if you can do a 60 to 90 day approach with fertile fatty foods, ketogenesis, recently Maria Emmerich has come out with a new book, and actually we're going to be giving away the Maria Emmerich's new keto cleanse, and we think it's really great. She's done a lot of work with Jimmy Moore, and she's got a great ketogenic adaptation.
Absolutely.
And so it's that 30-day plan. You know, it takes 20 days to create a new habit, and 30 days is kind of an even number.
Yes.
the human growth hormone prime was really meant to be 28 days, but we call it the 30-day prep.
Yeah.
And so if you can get 30 days of a change in the diet, add the LDN, add in the support, slow it down, I think that's really a really great start and approach to this whole process. And we've been really looking at a lot from Jason Fung, who's a great internist, diabetologist in Toronto, who's also worked with Maria Emmerich and Jimmy Moore and DietDoctor.com and shared some ideas how fasting can really help while you're doing that preparation. And quite often, that's all you need to get the prep. And then, voila, we've seen so many people conceive naturally and go on to that successful conception and delivery.
Absolutely. Next question is, does high BMI really cause a huge decrease in success rates for IVF? Also, would you recommend a mini IVF for women with very high BMIs?
Well, so high BMI, high weight, is correlated with reduced fertility outcomes, success, either natural or through IUI or IVF. That said, I don't think it's the weight itself. Yeah. I think it's what we consume in our bodies. And so literally doing that 30-day cleanse and the changing to a ketogenic diet and intermittent fasting, I believe you'll change the plasma on the energy that flows through your body and you'll reduce that inflammation that'll help with the success. Okay. That said, there's a lot of information that weight loss, Atkins, and even some people recommend doing gastric sleeve and gastric bypasses. I'm not a big proponent of it, but some people that may be all it takes, and I've had some physicians I've spoken with that actually practice that have seen so many women conceive by having that change in their BMI. So if you can change what you consume and go to the ketogenic diet, paleo diet, that may be all it takes. But really, I think that's helpful. We see a lot of women who don't lose the weight, but we simply help change the energy that's flowing and help in this. And definitely, in general, a higher BMI, even though you have a may have a high AMH, which means you have a lot of egg reserve, you tend to need a higher dose gonadotropins to stimulate the ovaries, and that low dose doesn't seem to work as well. Yeah. It never hurts to start low dose, start with a keto cleanse, and it is a difficult challenge to change our habits, but read and listen to this these ideas. It'll build the mind, which kind of helps vibrate and builds confidence. And I know that it's possible. Get a trash can, throw away all the food in your house, and start going to fresh organic foods every day rather than packaged. If it's in a bag, packaged, don't buy it, don't use it. That is really the biggest problem for all of us.
Absolutely.
So that said, you can still move into treatment. Don't hesitate. But it needs to be created and individualized for you.
Absolutely. Is there a higher rate of pregnancy doing either fresh or frozen transfers?
Well, we're finding that the frozen embryo transfer seems to be doing really the very best today. And it may come to a time we're doing no fresh. Certainly with a lower dose stimulation or natural stimulation and less than 150 to 225 of gonadotropin or letrozole or Clomid or even a natural may do as well as a frozen. But if you failed fresh, go to frozen, and definitely high dose gonadotropins, frozen seems to be the very best. We're doing a lot more on our donor egg side, where we're taking fresh eggs, with fresh or frozen sperm and creating frozen embryos and doing a thaw and transfer and doing really well with those also. So we think it used to be we thought fresh was best. Now we think a freeze-all and a frozen embryo transfer allows us to synchronize and coordinate the whole process even better.
Great. Are there certain circumstances in which PGS testing is recommended?
Well, certainly doing PGS testing where we think you have a history of chromosomally abnormal embryos that are the cause of that repetitive implantation failure. Or you have a known chromosomal abnormality, a deletion, or other genetic disorders that we think PGD, PGS may be beneficial. If you happen to make a lot of embryos, and you're looking for that one embryo, doing PGS may help us better identify that one embryo to transfer, which may reduce the number of transfers, the number of cycles, which may be of benefit. So I think that's where it falls into the best state. You need to make an embryo and put it in the uterus to define whether or not it's really normal or not. There's been some evidence, if you look at Norman Gleischer's work, that it's not completely accurate. There may be some mosaicism that goes with it. But in general, we think it has some value. It does add cost, and you have to sort of measure the cost and the transfer and the emotional state to all of that in making the decision to do that. Individualize it, I think, is really the very best. There's not one way to do any of this.
Great. Can you talk a little bit more about IVIG?
So intravenous immunoglobulins, IVIG. It's been around a long time. It's a product that used intravenously that has been used for many autoimmune or immunologic disorders where in many sick patients, it may be the only thing that helps them get better and feel better. We believe that the immune system is a big cause of many infertility issues and many repetitive implantation failures and early losses, and maybe even some late losses. The problem is, it's not easy to find who needs it. It's costly, insurance doesn't cover it quite often. But so is IVF and infertility treatments in general, and quite often we don't have a diagnosis in order to get you to that treatment, but it seems to be a benefit. I call it sort of a vacuum cleaner of the dysfunctional immune system. It's like an air filter in the bloodstream. So the IVIG circulates, and it may reduce the antigen-antibody interactions that modulates the immune system. And for the idiopathic or certainly the known autoimmune causes, but typically you're going to find that it might be someone who has lupus, or irritable bowel, Crohn's, colitis, psoriasis, or other autoimmune diseases where we've had patients that had other immune problems, used either Remicade or IVIG, and got pregnant and delivered a baby. And so we're finding that definitely there's some value. The problem is knowing exactly who it's going to benefit, and that's not always so straightforward. But I believe since the immune system tends to be the biggest culprit for most infertility, we should be looking at that early first and incorporating it either with natural IUI, IVF, donor eggs, or even in some cases, we've had some gestational carriers that may benefit from either IVIG, intralipids, prednisone, Humira, Neupogen, Prograf, or other immunologic modulators, and especially a high-fat, low-carb, no-sugar diet plan.
Great. Is it too late to start keto if your transfer is 2 to 3 weeks out, or any time is better than not starting at all?
I think the time to start keto is today, and ketogenesis, and you can do it with intermittent fasting. You can do it with adding a high-fat and really low carbs. It's a little harder for vegetarians, but some vegetarians do butter, high fat. They do even chicken and fish, but they just stay away from red meat. And really, it's quite variable. You have to find someone and really begin to read about it. I think there's very few people that understand it. I've been practicing it for about 2 years mm-hmm. to 3 years, and I found how well I feel, how my gut feels tremendously better. Mm-hmm. And we have so many people that text me or call me yeah. or email me a keto baby. Mm-hmm. And so if you're looking to do intercourse, IUI, IVF, whatever it is, yeah. anytime is the good time. And I believe we should be looking towards ketosis even in pregnancy. Mm-hmm. And the extra calories can be obtained through fat, yes. cream and butter mm-hmm. and fatty meat and fatty fish. So mm-hmm. I really talk about it a lot because I've been amazed when I had patients getting pregnant, delivering babies, that I said, well, how'd that happen? Like mm-hmm. everything we did didn't work, yeah. but you did this and how'd you find out about it? And I was amazed. DietDoctor.com, Maria Emmerichs, mm-hmm. Jimmy Moore, yeah. Jason Fung, and I've been reading a lot from Gary Taubes, Good Calories, Bad Calories, Why We Get Fat, mm-hmm. and The Case Against Sugar. It is quite amazing concepts and ideas. So today, there's a lot of podcasts and videos, mm-hmm. and if you're just eliminating grains and celiac, I don't think that's enough personally. Mm-hmm. I think it's really far greater than we're led to believe. But you know, I always say, do something you don't believe in, and I didn't. I did it myself and I was quite amazed. So give it a test ride and see what you think.
Great. The next client had a freeze-all cycle at the end of October. She had 10 mature eggs out of 13, 9 fertilized and all made it to blast to freeze. Her FET one day 5 for a embryo. The growth started slowing by 7 weeks and she had a DNC last Monday. She's nervous that the rest of her 8 embryos will fail too. Is it likely that the rest would be abnormal? They were not, PGS, PGD was not tested. Should she risk thawing, testing, and refreezing, or just go ahead and transfer those?
That's the $1 million yep. question. If you have a miscarriage that you can get fetal tissue from and test it, I recommend it. If it comes back chromosomally normal, that's where the immunologic treatment should really be focused on. Intralipids, IVIG, mm-hmm. and look towards Humira, even LIT therapy, where we refer patients to Markham Fertility in Toronto. Mm-hmm. Definitely thawing, biopsying, and refreezing embryos can be done. We do it, and mm-hmm. it's generally safe. If you don't have the information from the miscarriage on whether that's chromosomally normal or abnormal, it may be of value for peace of mind if that's the direction you want to go. Mm-hmm. I really, really believe the only way you're going to get success is you have to keep going, and you have to risk failure. That's the only way any of this and anything happens for any us in life. And that is the hardest part to this. But I just got to tell you, the more people that I see be persistent, find the support, yeah. talk to people, do the meditation, prayer, acupuncture, reading, writing, journaling, mm-hmm. That's going to get you there. And I always say you must risk an embryo not implanting or miscarrying to get the success you desire. Mm-hmm. And whether it's natural or assisted fertility, no one knows the way it's going to happen. Belief in that you will, you are, and it's mm-hmm. happening, it really is powerful and important.
Great. The next client had a failed IVF with a frozen transfer and the highest grade embryos. Do you know why this would have happened?
A failed?
Failed IVF, and her embryos had the highest grade at the time of transfer.
So, again, just because you have the best embryo, mm-hmm. I've seen the worst embryo become babies and the mm-hmm. best not. This is the mystery to all of this and mm-hmm. everything we know. We're scientists. If there were a 99% delivery rate from the embryos we knew would become babies, and even PGS embryos don't have yep. an 85-90% delivery rate, it's still in the 50-70% range, mm-hmm. and there's quite a variable number there. Yeah. I'm going to assume these were not PGS tested, and so it really is a matter of we don't know the reason it fails. It's either a bad embryo. Even though PGS embryos could be normal, there may be something else wrong with the embryo. Mm-hmm. Or again, it may be something going on with the environment. And that's where it comes to laparoscopy, hysteroscopy, look and treat endometriosis. Mm-hmm. the hidden C or other bacterial organisms that may be chronically inflaming the pelvis or the uterus, where a 2 to 4 week course of antibiotics may be helpful. And then the hysteroscopy D&C or the scratch procedure may be helpful. This is where the intrauterine HCG and the sub-Q Neupogen, the weekly intralipids, and then the monthly IVIG may be the next step. But it really may be simply putting in another embryo and retiming and re-prepping in the process. Believe me, this is the hard part to the whys. And we can whittle it down all we want. We have some theories. We mostly have some treatment ideas that do help in the process. We've recently been sending our clients to an immunologist and looking for markers that may help you feel better about doing the test and the treatment. Quachem, Allen Beer Center, we use a lot for those that desire it. If you have limited funds, your money is better spent in the treatment. Because if you really think about it, IVF is empiric therapy. Nothing worked before. We don't have a reason for you, but we know that IVF, which is expensive, helps. Well, we know that IVIG and intralipids and all these other treatments help, and they're not as expensive as you think. They may be a benefit for you. And I've been amazed at how many people benefit from that. So I hope I've helped in that. It really is, you have to trust that next embryo is going to be good, even though the grade might not be as perfect as you think it should be. I know from experience that plenty of not so good looking embryos make babies and perfect embryos don't. It's a subjective process, not as objective as you think it is.
Great. How often do you lose embryos in the thaw process?
We rarely lose embryos in the thaw process. It really is the biggest degradation is you collect 10 eggs and you're gonna get 5 to 8 that are mature. You add sperm to them and you're gonna get about 2/3 actually fertilize. And of those that fertilize, you may get about 2/3 that make it to a freezing or transfer stage, depending on the age and your history. But once they get frozen, 98% of them are viable at thawing for transfer, and about 50% of those may create a positive pregnancy, and depending on your age, somewhere between 30 and 60% actually become babies.
Yeah, absolutely. So the next client has seen recommendations regarding transfer to help your chances, such as eating pineapple, having primarily warm foods, keeping your feet warm, etc. What are your thoughts on this? Are there any recommendations that you have around transfer day to give us the best chance?
De-stress. I believe in the keto paleo diet is really important. I don't think pineapple is something I recommend since it's very high sugar. And we've seen a tremendous amount of change. The challenge is people smoke, don't get cancer, but we don't recommend smoking. The majority of people that smoke don't get cancer. So many people get pregnant doing things that often don't make sense. But we are really moving towards new ideas. Keto paleo,
acupuncture,
yoga, meditation, massage, prayer, slow it down.
Absolutely.
And that's where low-dose naltrexone, we're recommending IVIG and intralipids for many people. So immune modulation, really important. I think that sort of encompasses most of it. There are lots of ideas out there. If what you've been doing isn't working, our idea here is to shift it up. And we one other thing we've been also adding is light therapy. The CNY Healing Arts we've been recommending for some time now, and where we're really providing acupuncture, massage, yoga. Tai Chi, I think, is really another idea. Slow it down. And, you know, quite often, a little bit of insight in these things kind of makes sense. Slow it down. And nutrition, light therapy, we really think is something important to helping improve the success. And infrared lights, or seem to be mm-hmm. healing and helpful also.
Absolutely. And at all of our locations, Syracuse, Albany, and Rochester, and now Buffalo, every month we offer free workshops focusing on either yoga or acupuncture, nutrition, and we have a few other workshops coming up in the new year to give you an introduction to these. If it's something that you've never experienced before, you can have a little demo, speak with some of our practitioners, and learn more about the benefits.
And we have a lot on our website that can guide you mm-hmm. and your practitioner wherever you are in the
Absolutely.
World that will help you step into these new ideas mm-hmm. And take care of, I always say, take care of this, what you put in here and what you put in here, mm-hmm. and that'll often take care of what this is. And then don't do this running yeah. stuff. Slow it down, walk slow and mm-hmm. easy. Good thoughts, which really will help in the process.
Absolutely. So the next client is wondering what the lowest number of days to stimulation. Her natural cycle has only about 9 to 10 days from the last day of her menstrual cycle to ovulation, according to her fertility monitor.
Typically with a stimulated mm-hmm. cycle for IVF, it's about 10 days on average yeah. to stimulation. It's interesting for those people who tend to have shorter cycles, the stimulation maybe makes it a little bit longer, and those who have long cycles, the stimulation tends to make mm-hmm. it a little bit shorter. That said, we see some people that maybe mature as early as day 7, mm-hmm. But it really needs to be, again, individualized. Earlier scans may be helpful. We're working to simplify a lot of what we yeah. do, reducing a lot of the blood work, mm-hmm. doing simply an ultrasound maybe at the baseline in a day 7, 8, or 9 ultrasound to determine when to trigger for either intercourse, IUI, or IVF. Mm-hmm. And so earlier for some people, later for others, if you're yeah. in question, an ultrasound earlier, and we're typically looking for 16 to 18 millimeter mm-hmm. follicle, 7 to 8 millimeter lining before trigger, but we're finding the lining we're not so concerned about when it mm-hmm. comes to freeze all cycles, and the blood work may not be as important. So in our move to reduce cost, simplified IVF and yeah. fertility care, remember, we're not talking about just IVF, we're talking about helping mm-hmm. conception happen naturally with IUI, with IVF, with donor eggs,
yes.
However it's happening, whether you're single in a same-sex relationship, mm-hmm. However it is, we're here to really look at the process in a global fashion and really focusing on not just on the fertility treatments for infertility, mm-hmm. but also for reproductive failure yeah. losses early and late in the whole process. So
great.
I hope that answered the question.
Absolutely. What recommendations do you have for a type 2 diabetic before undergoing IVF? Any particular A1C that should be achieved prior?
So interesting enough, for diabetics, type 1 and type 2, and where they're either insulin or non-insulin dependent, mm-hmm. We know that glucose and insulin tend to be the toxic substances, mm-hmm. and getting a hemoglobin A1C below 5, mm-hmm. Really helpful. And the keto paleo diets, I mean, are phenomenal. Mm-hmm. Jason Fung, I think, is leading the way mm-hmm. on giving some information on how fasting and keto plans can really be of value. I would say the 30, 60, 90 days, get that down. And if you can do that and work to get off insulin, mm-hmm. and if you need some metformin, ovacetol we use a lot mm-hmm. of, we've been really surprised on its benefits,
yep.
but it's gonna help reduce the inflammation in the pelvis. Mm-hmm. That's gonna help with implantation or egg and sperm interactions or embryo travels or embryo implantation. Mm-hmm. It's gonna help tremendously. So, 5 or less. Mm-hmm. The interesting part is glucose is completely unnecessary in our diets. Mm-hmm. Carbohydrates are completely unnecessary mm-hmm. in our diets. That's the amazing concept
yeah.
that we're learning. And if you start reading this and looking at it, even talk to me, I'd be glad to talk mm-hmm. about it with you. It really is of value.
Great. Does decreased ovarian reserve affect the quality of embryos, or is age a bigger factor?
Decreased
ovarian reserve.
Egg reserve.
Mm-hmm.
So as women age, there seems to be a diminished ovarian reserve, mm-hmm. number of eggs, egg quality. But it's interesting, younger women with the diminished ovarian reserve, a low AMH, may still have good quality eggs and embryos. Mm-hmm. But I like to believe that by reducing inflammation in and around the pelvis and the ovary, we can improve the blood mm-hmm. flow to the ovary. We can improve the ovarian yeah. function. We may boost the ovarian reserve, or we may simply boost the quality of eggs mm-hmm. and quality of embryos in the process. DHEA, acupuncture, mm-hmm. massage, light therapy, keto paleo diets, mm-hmm. intermittent fasting, are all part of the process. Yeah. Even a laparoscopy, looking for and removing endometriosis. Two patients today had no idea that they might have endometriosis, mm-hmm. had moderate to severe endometriosis. Yeah. The good news, the ovaries looked relatively spared and the mm-hmm. tubes, but it was lining the pelvis that definitely are gonna affect the egg and sperm interaction, embryo travel. But reducing that may help the quality of the eggs mm-hmm. and may help it improve the odds. So, and then the ovulation stimulation, human growth hormone, even Neupogen, Lovenox, low dose steroids mm-hmm. can help in the blood flow, and that's where even IVIG and interlipids may help modulate the immune system, mm-hmm. help the blood flow, and I believe it also can help the prostate mm-hmm. and the testes and the male quality function and quantity in the process.
Great. Will an RPL panel determine if she has an autoimmune issue? The next client is wondering.
So the RPL panel, so looking at natural killer cells, C-reactive protein, hemoglobin A1C, mm-hmm. And looking at interleukins, TH1, TH2, looking at anti-thyroid antibodies, anti-nuclear antibodies. Mm-hmm. There's a whole host of tests that can yeah. be run to look for the inkling of an idea that you might have an immunologic or autoimmune process. Mm-hmm. If you talk to most immunologists, rheumatologists, they'll tell you it's mostly a clinical definition. And really, it's mm-hmm. it's somewhat of a shotgun approach yep. in defining it. It's a clinical looking for certain triad mm-hmm. of clinical signs yeah. and symptoms that help us. In my opinion, those tests aren't very accurate mm-hmm. and they can be misleading, although there may be some value looking at MTHFR mutations, look at protein C, protein S, mm-hmm. and other thrombophilias could be helpful. And the testing is valuable if it helps you psychologically or it helps get your insurance mm-hmm. company to cover the mm-hmm. medications that yeah. may be important for you. So that's where I really find it's valuable. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, so many people are spending their nut on the diagnostic testing yeah. and now they have no money for the treatment. And so my philosophy is, if it's idiopathic, it's immunologic mm-hmm. inflammation. And let's take it from a sort of a global approach in helping you find that. But Absolutely. In general, NK cells, looking at glucose, insulin, hemoglobin mm-hmm. levels, looking at CRP, ANA, antithrombin, antithyroglobulin antibodies, antithyroid antibodies, and then looking at TH1, TH2 mm-hmm. levels. That's kind of a good approach. Yeah. We do work with Quakim Beer Institute and your local rheumatologist mm-hmm. Could be helpful.
Great. What are the chances of an embryo splitting if only one is transferred?
So the splitting of an embryo happens. It's a small risk. It's about a 2-5% mm-hmm. risk that single embryo that you transferred yeah. might become an identical twin.
Absolutely. Can you grow eggs that are taken out before they mature, or are they considered not viable?
So an immature egg that is retrieved from an ovary mm-hmm. can be matured in vitro, okay. and there is some culture media or simply mm-hmm. culturing overnight may be all it takes to mature an egg. and adding certain medications mm-hmm. to the culture media may be also what it takes to improve the maturation of eggs. Mm-hmm. So in general, we take an immature egg, we hold it overnight in the culture media, and preferably in the overnight or several day media that is necessary for in vitro maturation. Mm-hmm. The media is a little more expensive. You have to have it on hand ahead of time. So it's rare that we see someone that has no mature eggs, but if you're finding no mature eggs, it may be simply triggering earlier or later, modifying the gonadotropin stimulation or being ready for it and adding that in vitro maturation fluid to the culture media.
Good. So the next client has been hearing more and more about single embryo transfers splitting and resulting in twins. Is this occurring more frequently, and does assisted hatching have anything to do with the increased splitting rate?
Both injection ICSI of sperm into the egg mm-hmm. and the assisted hatching and the embryo biopsy all are factors in increased risk of splitting and identical twins from mm-hmm. a single embryo transfer. But it's not happening more commonly today than it was in the past. Yeah. It really is about the same, mm-hmm. but we're doing many more single embryo transfers yeah. where previously if you were doing a dual embryo transfer and you had twins, mm-hmm. you may not actually know as much as you thought you knew and mm-hmm. whether or not they split because one lost mm-hmm. or they were really separate embryos.
Great. And her last transfer, the next client had acupuncture, and it wasn't really for her. Does massage have the same benefits, or is acupuncture better?
Acupuncture, massage, mm-hmm. meditation, light yeah. therapy, all these things are valuable. And I know you find the thing that feels good for you, mm-hmm. because if it's not psychologically feeling good,
absolutely.
It's physiologically going to be bad.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so that's really how I believe most of this works for us.
Mm-hmm.
It's something that releases some of the opiates
yeah.
And some of the feel-good stuff, and that feel-good of the massage, or the acupuncture, or the light therapy,
yeah.
it helps reduce reactive oxygen species, mm-hmm. nitric oxide levels are increased, and voila. Implantation is improved. So if acupuncture doesn't work for you
yeah.
and I can understand it, move on to something else in the process.
Circle and Bloom is a company that we've worked with in the past. We've had a nice relationship with them, and they have really great meditation specifically for certain points during your cycle, and they have a few really nice meditations that you can download onto your phone and pop some earbuds in during your transfer, during that resting period, and they walk you through a great visualization and meditation just for those 10, 15, 20 minutes that you're lying on the table. And so that might be a nice option as well to help you feel like you're actively doing something during the transfer process and instead of the acupuncture.
And we do light therapy.
Absolutely.
And we do massage and my massage or abdominal mm-hmm. pelvic massage before and after.
Yeah.
The transfer rooms are low lighting,
they're
comfortable
beautiful.
Mm-hmm. massage tables, appropriate music.
Mm-hmm.
But if there's something you want to hear,
absolutely,
we highly recommend it. Partners are welcome for mm-hmm. the transfer, or a friend or a family
yeah.
member that'll give you that extra support.
Mm-hmm.
We think it's really helpful. One of the ideas